rush out of the cornucopia with your supplies as you are dragging Mina along out of harm's way. You seem to have gotten far away from the cornucopia to where the violence echoes of either clashing steel or running or screaming kind of dim down there. You enter into this jungle biome. This is not a forest that you're familiar with. This is more of a rainforest than the one you're used to back home. Tall brush, vines, leaves, and moss growing everywhere, and tall, tall, tall trees, upwards to 100 to 200 feet tall, with a massive jungle canopy that has scattered sunlight in between. Mina ever so softly thanks you for kind of getting her out of there. What's the first thing that you do?
Check my backpack, probably.
Okay, roll me a d4.
4.
Well, in your backpack, you open up another canteen. So you have 2 canteens now. Hey, you found a medicine, a little vial of medicine. A food supply. You're just setting yourself up. This is frustrating me.
Yeah, fuck you. 2.
A rope. Hey, there's your rope.
Okay. Got food.
She's a little disappointed that you didn't find any electrical wire. Make a perception roll for me, please, Maeve.
Oh, 5.
This catches you a little off guard, just as it catches them off guard. But as you look up, you notice at the edge of this zone, you see 2 other tributes. It's Paisley and Ian. They have their backpacks open as they were doing the same as you. They're digging through and gathering their inventory. They're looking at you with a kind of confused expression that you caught them off guard, almost as they caught you off guard. As it was just kind of like this tension as you guys are like kind of looking across. What do you do?
I feel like I keep eye contact with them. And I'm like, Mina, put the stuff back in the backpack.
Mina zipped up your backpack. You notice that they don't close their backpack. They're just staying there.
I don't want to engage with them yet. I'm not trying to fight anyone yet.
Got anything good? That was fucking hell, wasn't it? Did you see that kid's head pop like a balloon? And then Ian's like, gnarly.
No, I don't want to trade. Sorry.
Are you scared, Ginger Jack?
No.
You know, I'm surprised to see you out here.
Did you think I was gonna die?
No, I just thought that Mommy and Daddy would have wanted you to hang out with the careers, you know, since you're a capital whore. As you notice that she reaches into her bag and she draws a knife. She starts taking a couple steps towards you. Roll initiative.
16.
She starts taking these menacing steps towards you with the knife, and Ian's sitting there back. You have the initiative. You beat her initiative with that 16. She rolled a 13. What's your first action?
I'm gonna like somersault the hell out of there and like come up so that her back's to me.
Make an attack roll for me, please, with that axe.
19 and 9.
So you somersault, catching her off guard there as you get behind her and your axe. What's your swing look like?
I feel like I'm a one-handed like slice.
Oh my fucking god. Okay, roll your damage. Roll d10.
I don't know where I hit her. I feel like I'm acting out of impulse because I'm like new to this fighting biz.
1d10 damage and then double it for your perk.
2.
She is quick on her feet to the where your axe blade only singes part of her forearm there as it's not a deep enough cut. As now I need you to make a dexterity roll to dodge as now her knife is coming down upon you. As this junkie is trying to murder you.
21.
She slashes into your flesh, digs into your shoulder. It goes about halfway through the blade as you take 7 damage as that blade comes out and it is colored with your blood. You're up. Mina, she goes to hide. Mina goes behind a tree. You kind of lose sight of Mina for just a moment. Ion seems to be lurking around the brush. As you notice that he's folding up he has a net in his hand as he's kind of like curling around. It is your turn again.
I have to keep fighting this one?
Don't have to keep fighting her. You could make a break for it, but she will pursue you.
18.
Roll your damage, d10 plus 2, or times 2.
Okay, come on. 4.
That stumbles for a little bit as the axe does.
I just want to like...
You've dealt 6 total damage to her, now you gotta make a dodge.
I got 7.
Okay, I'm gonna give a tie goes to the defender because I like your hair. So... So this blade, yeah, kind of deflects off your axe there as sparks fly as Ian kind of gets closer and he throws the rope at you. He throws the rope at you. Please make a dexterity roll because they're trying to trap you right now.
19 and 19. Fuck off.
Okay, you basically just fling that rope right back on him.
Yeah!
As it hits the ground, and then Ian's kind of disappointed at that as he goes to try and pick up the net again. He's in his turn. You're up again now.
6 and 19. 25.
Axe damage.
6.
She thinks that she's winning this fight. She is confident, and she's
and
like...
And he's just hanging around?
And Ian is now trying to pick up his net that you just deflected.
Fuck him.
Paisley, you notice that she is like... frenzied. She is like full adrenaline, full power, not caring about herself. She has one objective with her eyes, and that is just to just, you just see murder in her eyes. She's trying to kill you again. Please make a dodge roll.
23.
You get cut around across the stomach. You take 3 more damage there. As you guys are now tumbling around in the brushes. You just are stabbing and trading axes. You do notice that Ian is picking up that net as Mina approaches behind him with a rock, as she goes clunk, and Ian kind of gets hit in the back of the head, and he falls onto the ground, as Ian is kind of unconscious at this current moment. So it's just you and Paisley now. Make your attack
job,
roll,
Mina.
As you two are shank, 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 shank.
8.
Miss.
20.
Yep, nope. 2 more damages. She's now kind of digging into the side of your rib cage here with this blade.
I'm literally about to die.
How much health do you have?
16.
Well, maybe you should hit.
Maybe I should try.
Tumbling with her right now.
I guess so.
Oop.
13. Fuck that.
10.
I'm tumbling with her though, right? Mm-hmm. I'm just gonna like fucking take this part and just like.
Okay, let's see if the dice reflect that. D10 times 2. Oh!
10.
Your spike of the axe goes through her jaw as you see it come on the other end of her mouth as she's screaming, "Aish!" As her blood starts trickling down onto you as she is on death's door. She is almost dead, but she's now connected to your axe where the only last thing she has left to do is to try and kill you before she goes down. Please make one last dodge with your kind of head there, as you're gonna have to swivel this knife coming down upon you.
24.
Nearly, it goes right past your head and digs into the dirt as she's still right there. Please roll me one last attack.
18.
Roll that axe one more time.
4.
How do you kill Paisley of District 6?
Oh my gosh. I feel like I wanna like get my knee basically like in between us, and I'm gonna shove her off, flip it, and just like slice her neck. Quick. I wanna make sure she's dead.
Her blood splats on a nearby bush as it kind of drains and drips off of that leaf as her lifeless body slumps over. Immediate cannon in the sky, booming throughout the entire arena. You are lying on your back, covered in her blood and your own blood, as Mina reaches her arm down for you. Just this innocent face, just like...
Nice rock.
As she lifts you up, and you both stand as you hear Ian's heavy breathing as he's currently unconscious in front of you.
Can I take their backpack?
You can take both their backpacks.
Might as well, right?
Okay, so she had a knife. Do you want the net?
Might as well. If I can.
Yeah.
Might as well take it, right?
Mina straps on that backpack. She gestures with her eyes, Ayan. What do you do?
Girl, you started that one. That's up to you.
I don't think I have the guts to...
kill him?
Yeah.
Or leave him?
She gestures to the rock that has a little bit of his blood on the back of it. She drops it.
I can't believe they're making murderers of us. I can't decide. I can't make this decision on my own. You're not willing to kill anyone.
Well, if you're not either, then we should go.
I don't want to use my rope, though.
Oh my god.
I was gonna say I could, like, tie him to a tree.
Oh, you're gonna hang him!
No. No, and let, like, someone else find him. No, let's just get out of here. I'm done for today.
Okay, very well. You two, look back.
I feel like that's gonna bite me in the ass. Once more.
Taro, you escape the bloodbath and are stumbling through this thick foliage of the jungle as you seemingly get far enough away from the cornucopia to where the sounds of clashing steel seems to fade away. You enter what seems to be a clearing in the jungle where you're able to walk around. It is clear and lush, as tailing a little bit further behind you is Amaris. Mm-hmm. And as she approaches, she's not very used to trekking through the jungle. She's approaching, she's getting whipped with all these vines. She looks sickly pale. And you know that she's around you because you can even smell the scent of this perfume. This capital perfume that's like kind of on her arena suit that you can only kind of defer that this was sprayed on by her mentor before she went up, just like a little piece of home. But it's very, very noticeable and pungent when she does approach. What's the first thing that you do now that you have a chance to catch your breath?
What's wrong?
We're fucked. This is so fucked. Did you hear Jareth scream?
Yes, I heard it. There's nothing we can do about that right now.
I knew he was gonna go, but nobody deserves.
Hey, it was fast. Okay? That's all that we can hope for anyone that we'd like in this arena. But right now, let's just focus on going forward.
She looks up and she shoots darts at you as she's glaring at you. She gets in your face and she starts kind of shoving you. So what do we do? What do we do now, huh? You're the survival guy. You're supposed to get me through this. What do we do? What do we need?
I'm gonna look for my backpack.
She's panicking as she's going. She's like looking throughout the trees and everything like that. You're looking through your backpack?
Yeah.
Okay, roll me a d4.
2.
Okay, you get 2 items. Roll me that d12.
12. 9.
Okay, so this backpack felt a little heavy, and you now know why. The first thing that you pull out is your everyday knife. So you do have this knife. It's a d8 damage. And then also, funny enough with your rock obsession, literally you pull out this pickaxe, this coated pickaxe, as that seems to be all you got from that backpack.
Okay.
She refuses to go any further in the jungle with what you guys have. She's kind of manic right now. You can't really get through to her if you want to try and calm her down.
No one is prepared. No one's prepared right now.
Make a charisma check. Let's see if you can calm her down.
14 plus 2, 16.
You do successfully calm her down, and she's like, all right, I'm sorry.
That's okay.
Okay, I have the 6 sponsors. What do you need? What do you need to get through this? They like me because I'm pretty and I smile and they plan on profiting off of my clothing industry if I make it through.
It's a big if.
She stares at you so blankly after that.
I'm good with the slingshot. I don't know what you are good with in terms of weapons. I think we can find food. I think we're good with that. Maybe, if anything, like a spigot to get some water out of the trees, or a water bottle.
Canteen, a spile, a slingshot. Do you need medicine, rope, food, med kits?
I feel like if we need medicine, I feel like I can find enough stuff around us to deal with whatever we're dealing with. I don't think we need medicine.
That's reassuring. Okay, do you want to hold on to the other three sponsors, or or should we just call it in now?
No, we should save them, for sure.
She then, all the tributes are kind of given that little sponsor hologram to select their items there as she pulls up. It's like almost like a little wrist bracelet she pokes in. It's like ordering off of an iPad at a restaurant. She's like, okay, canteen, spile here. You see that her sponsor credits go down. As there's a moment of delay, a bright flash above happens as you start to, you can kind of see through this thick canopy of trees, these chrome canisters parachuting down on white silk chutes as they start gracefully landing as you hear this beeping. Two canisters ever so gracefully land into the soil there as you're able to unload them.
Okay.
She opens one and hands you the spile. She doesn't know what it is. As you open up the spile and the canteen, the slingshot's missing.
Where's the slingshot?
Make a perception roll.
21.
You realize that only two out of three of your canisters landed on the ground. As you look up and stuck in the canopy, seems that one of the chutes got tangled along some branches there as it's about a 100-foot climb up of these giant jungle trees.
Okay.
They both are looking at it now. I'm not getting it.
Yeah, I know you're not getting it. I'm gonna get it. It's fine.
You're going up there?
Yes, I'm gonna get it. We need that. We don't know. Well, we're gonna need it. I climb.
Make a dexterity check, please.
21.
Beautiful. Okay, you ascend this ginormous 100-foot tree as it's slow and steady. The branches, the ones that are close to this trunk are very stable. It's almost like you're climbing a ladder. You've done this a million times back in District 12. You make it to the tree canopy line as you see that the canister is just a little out of reaching range. And you do notice with your perception that the branches are thinner. They seem to be weaker. Seems like this is a, you would have to shift your weight balance in such a way to not break the branches as you reach for this canister. It's just a little bit, just like about 5 feet out of range.
Okay.
Do you take the risk?
What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna hook my toe around the trunk.
Okay.
And then I'm gonna trust that.
Okay, let's do some core ab exercises here. Hooking your feet around this thing as you're trying to just extend, just trying to reach
a little bit.
Okay, all right, with avoiding the branches, make that dexterity roll.
15.
It's just out of reach. You are able to hold your balance and do it, but you aren't able to. It's too far. It's about 5 feet out.
But can I snap off a branch and kind of?
Oh, okay.
Fish it off.
So you snap off one of the little twigs. You do notice that it would be a tough climb. Like it'd be a very risky move to trust them to grab the canister. But you do grab one as you're trying to undo that tangle there with that strength check.
Okay. A 9.
Still stuck up there. Be careful!
Amaris is
yelling. You hear that echoing down from the baseline. It's just like this little speck. You know that if you fall, it would be about a d20 damage.
Okay. She can't hear me, right?
No.
Okay. Thank you, as if I didn't know that. What am I gonna do? Can I perception for anything? Like, check anything?
What would you be looking for?
I don't know. Like, because I didn't bring any of these up, did I?
Maybe the knife?
Can I try to reach and use the knife to just cut the strings and have it fall to the ground?
You would be able to do that if you can put your weight on one branch. Not, okay. You won't be completely using both branches, but you just need that little extra reach there. So if you roll me one dex, you can. If you trust that one branch to hold on.
I'm gonna try that.
20 or above, or this branch okay. will snap, and then we'll go into free fall.
No! I'm so scared. Oh, 24.
Yes. So you notice, you hear that branch slowly cracking the longer you're sawing that branch. As you do release the chute, the canister just goes, it spirals down to the ground. You know, Amaris is taking cover. As when you lean your weight back, that branch does snap. Okay. And now you're back on the tree trunk as you can freely
okay.
ascend or descend.
I hear it hit the ground and I'm like, watch out. Yeah, okay, so I climb back down.
Okay, as you get back down there, Amaris has already opened the canister and hand you that slingshot.
Okay.
You currently don't have any ammo for it, but you could find it among the rocks.
Right. Yeah, can I perception for some, like, small rocks, and then I'm going to put that, if I find them, I'll put them in my,
yes.
my backpack.
Yes, go for it.
26.
Oh, okay, you can have about 6 perfectly shaped rocks that are great for ammunition here. They're not too clunky. You know that they'll be on target.
Okay, we've got stuff. Will you go forward now? Will you keep going with me? Okay, let's go.
What do we look for? Food, shelter, water? We have nothing.
Can I perception if I hear anything
yes.
in the distance?
Yes, you other... absolutely can.
19.
Hey, guess what? Just outside the brush line, you notice that there are footsteps heavy enough to be humanoid just beyond...
Humanoid?
Humanoid. Just beyond the brush over here that seems to be almost walking... Something's scoping you out pretty much, and you do hear that now that you're back down here and focused, that something's on the other side of that brush.
Did you hear that?
Did I hear what?
Someone's here. Shh. Okay, I'm gonna grab my slingshot. I'm gonna aim it, and I'm not gonna shoot it though. I'm gonna be like, come out right now.
You notice that the footsteps stop now that they realize that they've been identified. You see walking out of this brush line, you see Michaela of District 5 walk out. She has her hands up, pebbles and perfume. You do know that people can see those, right? You just shot down like 3 sponsor tokens. Yeah, they made a lot of noise. If I could find you, so could the careers.
I'm sorry, okay? I'm not sure what I'm doing. I'm doing my best. I'm glad it's you.
That's a first.
Well, what do you have on you? I mean, listen, I'm not trying to kill you right now is all I'm saying.
Yeah, interesting choice of words here. She pulls out this futuristic Zippo. She's flicking it back and forth. Yeah, they weren't too gracious with the loot near my backpacks, that's for sure.
It's okay, mine wasn't too full either. Well, you can come with us if you want. I think what we're going to do is I think we should try to get some water out of these trees. All right, I'm going to do that. I'm going to stick this in. And then I'm gonna fill up both of our canteens.
This is a rainforest, so there's a lot of moisture within these trees. As you dig in, you maybe take the blunt end of your knife and get it into the tree as fresh water pours out from these things. You notice that while your canteen's filling on the third water supply, there is a beam of sunlight that seems to kind of go past the canopy line, and it's gracefully on your shoulder as you immediately feel the change in temperature as there's like a great warmth that just ever so lightly hits your shoulder.
Yeah.
And this beam just like kind of just like emerges almost like the heavens above as it just kind of shines like a little circular radius right here. What do?
I look up.
As you look up, you notice that it has burned a hole through that upper layer of the canopy and is burnt through the holes of these branches, as you notice that there starts to be a bubbling, searing pain that immediately shifts on your shoulder. Make a dexterity roll for me, please!
Oh my gosh. 4.
This, as you looked up, as this all happened, as this the intensity of this beam increases by 1,000-fold, as you notice that it just... It opens up a layer of your flesh.
Oh my God.
As you receive 3 damage
okay.
and under conditions second degree burn. You get out of the way of this beam as Amaris is like, what the hell is going on? And Michaela's like, she's kind of like tiptoeing back like,
don't touch the sun.
You notice that dozens of these beams slowly start scattering through this zone here. Okay. They're focused. They're almost think of like a theater high beam light. They're all down here as Michaela, one's about to spawn on her as she tiptoes around, as she's staying in the shade, as everyone's kind of avoiding these beams of light. Make another dexterity roll for me, please.
9.
One spawns right on top of you as you do get clipped for another 3 damage as you get burned yet again. You see that triple the amount of sun rays are coming down from the canopy. As you start to see it, their beams are getting stronger. They're about to entertain them. There's gonna be more sunlight on this ground than shade here.
10.
3 more damage.
Oh my god.
Make another dexterity. We're gonna roll until you either die or you get into the shade. As you are tiptoeing around, you do notice that one scorches Michaela too as she's burning. You are all 3 getting fried right now as you're trying to find your spacing in the shade. Again.
Fuck! 5.
Another 1 damage. You're getting clipped left and right. Your hand, your hands, your arms, your legs, your feet, as they're just...
Okay, 23.
It's enough.
Okay.
You finally find your footing as you are in this very awkward pose here as you're seeing the flesh that's... freaking flayed off of your skin. Michaela suffered several burns as well as she's there, but what you do hear is the brutal, painful screaming from Amaris as she gets hit by one, as she starts panicking and she tries to run through the sunbeams to escape the entire zone. And she's screaming and you're seeing her basically just get melted and her face disfiguring and sinking in as she's running through the sunlight trying to escape.
Shade, find shade!
The scream stops as she hits the ground, as she's in between these beams that are continuously shined upon her as a thunderous cannon in the sky.
Amaris?
The corpse becomes to become more disfigured and mangled, and you're smelling the awful stench of burnt flesh as Michaela is also trying to cover her nose as well, as it's just a grueling, gruesome sight. As eventually the sun fades, as there's nothing left but the smoke of all the ash from this burnt ground and the dismangled corpse of Amaris.
I don't know. I don't know what to do. I don't know. Please tell me what to do. I don't know what to do. I'm scared.
Let's get out of here.
Okay, where do we go?
Anywhere but here. Come on. Angel, you, Jay, and Asher sprint through this dense jungle as Asher begins to slow down and slow down the pacing of this group as he starts to check his surroundings. You're in a jungle clearing. You're in a good tactical spot where you can see about 15 feet or 30 feet around you. You can see basically everything, so nothing can really sneak up on you in this particular zone. As Asher, I think we're good here. As then Jay... takes her backpack and dumps it down and starts going through it. I'll check inventory as Asher then hands her his backpack. Jay's going through both of them. They both are doing that for a second as Jay then looks for you and your backpack.
You want to check through it?
She genuinely appreciates your trust. So just note that she kind of laughs almost a little bit, like that was like, Asher's like, what the fuck, this guy's fucking crazy. As you just willingly handed your backpack to these 2 strangers, as now she's digging through, you and Asher are kind of standing guard. Mm-hmm. Is there anything that you do in this particular area while you wait?
Are we in a clearing? Are we under trees?
There is just thick foliage everywhere. I'd say knee-high bushes and moss-covered stone and... Mm-hmm. It gets thicker past that 30 feet where there are magnificently tall trees, up like 100 feet trees, like 8-foot wide diameter trees that just shoot up and just have this immense canopy dangling down. You are completely immersed in this biome here.
I've never seen anything quite like it.
Asher's there, he's just looking too, and he's like, he didn't really think to like look up and admire it in any way. He just thinks it's all fucked, but he does kind of take in the scenery. You know, this is probably all fake, right?
But I guess still pretty.
It's real enough to us. Yeah, I guess it is still pretty. You guys are awkwardly like standing there, like, you know, looking at the trees and chatting.
Nice trees.
And chatting.
You make a lot of paper out of this.
Paperboy joke. You know, let me talk to you a minute. As he then kind of steps away from Jay, or at least out of earshot, do you follow?
I'm going to look quickly at Jay.
She's in the middle here, so you have like a clear line of sight.
Okay. I'll follow him over.
Angel, I do not get you. I do not understand who the hell you are, because you show up to that train station, you do your little flips and your flaunts. I mean, I almost gagged watching you lift the ginger jack in the air, and then you do your chariot thing, and then next thing you know, you throw it all away in the interviews. And then you pair up with us, so you obviously want a shot at this. So what are you doing here?
So you probably heard during the interview what happened to me and my parents.
Yeah, awfully convenient.
Convenient?
You think it's any sort of chance that you're here, that your name was picked on the last year you were eligible, and you think that your district mate, being the one that whose parents turned in yours as your district mate, seems like an awfully convenient story.
Are you saying the deck's stacked?
I think you heard me.
Oh, fuck.
But what do
God,
I know?
God, it makes so much sense.
I'm just a harvester from District 11. He looks to Jay, and you notice that as he kind of watches her go through the inventory, that he smiles, and he kind of looks back to you. You know, I've known Jay since I was a kid. He used to send the children to climb the orchard trees to pick the fruit. That's where we became friends. I got stung by a tracker jacker once and fell from the tree, and that's the first time that she healed me. About a week before the reaping, my family was starving. We're all starving. And I, you know, took some of the food that we grow for the capital to feed them, got caught. Peacekeepers dragged me to the middle of the courtyard and beat me to an inch of my life. I would have died if it wasn't for Jay. I think they wanted me to die too. They didn't like that pretty much, so when her name, ever so conveniently, was called at the reaping, I volunteered for the mail that was called. That's right, I volunteered for this shit. Why? Because she's worth it. She deserves a ticket home.
You want to know my deal?
I'd love to know your deal.
I thought maybe I would try and play the game. Maybe I would put on a little show for them. It's what they want, right? And maybe it would give me a chance to kill one and two.
Yeah, good luck.
Yeah.
You hear that kid scream?
Yeah. That was... You know, I heard, we've all seen the games before. I've seen one and two in action. It's different up close. I've never seen anyone die before.
I have. All the time. They're not too nice to us in 11.
So I've heard.
Jay seems to finish up counting inventory as she kind of calls you guys back. Asher kind of taps you on the shoulder and like, let's go check it out. It seems that your inventory, you pretty much, Jay says that you seem to have enough supplies to really last quite a little bit there. It seems like you have, I mean, from the large crate, you have plenty of medicine and medkit, about three of each. You have canteens and food supplies and ropes and everything. It seems like the ball's in your court on what your next move is or what natural resources or shelter or anything that you'd want to do. Mm-hmm. But morale seems to be high right now.
Hey, I just want to get a few things out of the way real quick. I'm never going to turn on you. I know that's hard to believe. I know that's not how the games ever work. But I will never kill another enemy of the Capitol. If it comes down to it, I'll run. Maybe I'll try and outsurvive you, but I will never, ever try to kill you or Jay.
Jay looks to you. Well, anarchist, you could start by helping me up. She was on the ground, and you help her up. They trust you. They fully trust you. Even Asher, he's pretty much looking at you like a buddy right now, instead of everybody always on guard and cautious. All right, what's our next move? We got all the stuff.
First things first, we can survive a little bit without food.
Yes.
But we don't know if we can survive tonight without shelter.
Make a survival roll.
15.
Angel, as you guys enter this new zone, as you're looking for shelter, you seem to be leaving almost the jungle biome temporarily as your footsteps start to sink into the ground a couple inches and make a squishing sound as the water becomes a little bit more damp, even a puddle here or there. Moving through as something that gets stuck a little bit. So there's basically like, I'd say, ankle deep of mud now on your arena suit as it squishes around. Visibility is atrocious here. I'd say that there's almost like a phantom mist that kind of whisks around. You could probably only see about 5 to 10 feet. I need you to make a perception roll for me, please.
12.
Deep within the fog, but you hear a mutated, almost demonic croak that has like a low rumble that kind of like it echoes in three patterns, and it seems to be like something communicating. And then you hear that croak from the left of you. It seems that things are surrounding you in this fog. I need you to make another perception roll for me, please.
Asher, Jay.
They have weapons at the ready. Jay has a blow dart gun and a dart ready, and then Asher has his sickle ready to go.
16.
These are heavy footsteps that are also splashing on damp ground as well as you hear them. They are at least double your size. The splashing is, it almost sends a little bit of a rumble to you.
Can I tell if the splashing is like bipedal or if it's...
Yep, 1 foot after the other. You almost see the frame of this hulking creature, the silhouette of it kind of run through the mist as they're drawing in closer to you. The croaks get louder and louder as Asher's basically getting ready to fight as he kind of nudges you on the back. Like, if you're going, are you going like back to back, or if you're gonna like, how do you want to cover your angles here?
I'm gonna indicate for us all to square up triangle, back to back to back.
Looks like we got our first gift from the Capitol.
God, what are these things?
One last perception roll for me, please. And this is the most important one.
Ho, 24.
Beautiful, thank God, holy shit. Okay, then you see this. You see where one of them emerges as running at you with its elongated arms out and its foot-long claws. And I mean a foot-long of these curled claws. You see these amphibious mutations running from the mist. They stand 8 feet tall. They're disfigured and mangled. They're a blood red color with a kind of like a disgusting slime residue just coated all over its body as it's kind of dripping down. It has poisonous green spots all over it. Its head is like that of like a frog or toad, but it's like crunched and humanoid as its mouth expands to the end as these fangs just come out as these eyes that are bent on prey come charging at you.
Jesus Christ!
Almost all angles here as two of them seem to be coming for you and Asher, both of you.
As they're at distance, can I take my spear?
You absolutely can! Okay, make your strength roll. You're using that paperboy strength to hurl this spear.
Yes, sir. Let's do this thing! Oh, hell yeah, okay, so that's gonna be a 28.
Hit! Roll your damage.
Whoa!
No way! No way!
As this giant frog comes at us, I think it opens its mouth and it tries to shoot out its tongue at my spear. But as it shoots it out, I hurl the spear.
Holy fuck.
As it's coming out, it hits it right in the mouth.
And out the other end?
And out the other end.
Slew of purple, thick, mud-like blood goes spurting out the other side. Is
Jesus.
That one of these mutated frogs dips back and just immediately drops as moving past it, and that second one is now right on top of you. I need you to please make two dodges for me, please. One for each claw.
Eight.
First, you take 6 damage as this nails dig into you. As you notice that as the claw finishes its stroke, there's a very thin, water-like liquid that's dripping out of its claws of venom. I need you to make a constitution save for me, please.
Oh, hell yeah. Okay, that's 28.
Second dodge.
14?
You dodge. Asher, he charges forward at one of these things as he takes his sickle and he digs that hook into the top of his forehead and just pries open his brain cavity as that purple blood then just goes there as he then splits its neck as it falls. And the other one comes. He killed that first one, dodged that first swing, hit that second one, and tears open his chest as the pain doesn't seem to get him as he retaliates and swings and strikes at it, slashing at its arm as there's a delayed reaction as you notice that he goes stiff and he just paralyzes as his body hits into this puddle on the ground as you hear a large splash as he can't move. He's paralyzed as he drops. As Jay takes her blow dart and shoots at this last one, this last remaining guy, and she hits with this dart as it goes through, kind of backs off of Asher. It's your turn.
Is Asher lying face down or face up?
Face up.
Okay. First, I'm gonna take the mace, and I'm going to baseball swing at the one that's on me.
Okay, make a strength roll with the mace.
32.
Hit! 2d8.
8 damage.
You bash its skull in, but it's like you sink into one side of its head, but it's still there with its tongue as it's now gonna try and claw you again. Please make another dodge. God.
Okay, 17?
Oh, you absolutely dodge. Another one.
Oh, okay, 25.
Oh, thank God. Okay, just one, the second one. Jay is trying to distract that one that was going for Asher. Is now that one's charging her as she gets this opportunity attack here. Mm-hmm. Her dart just goes just a little bit off, and because she's backing up, and I think her foot sinks into one of the puddles just a little bit too much before she fired. Shot goes wide. That thing comes and basically tackles Jay onto the mud right there. Is now you're up on. It's your turn.
Okay, I'm gonna have to go for the one that's on Jay.
You let this thing try and swing at your back on his opportunity attack. Make a dodge.
Oh hell yeah, that's a 28.
Stop scaring me like this. Okay, you run past the one that's, you bash that skull in as it, due to its pain, it just kind of winces back before it gets a grip. As you now rush to the one that's on top of Jay.
I'm gonna tackle it at the same time, try and bash it with the base of the mace.
Strength roll.
14.
Hit, roll your damage.
Woo! Okay.
He's wounded.
7.
How do you kill it?
Kick it up. And as I kick it up, I'm gonna bring down the mace into its head and swing it back down into the ground.
With a crushing blow, you hear the bones crunching inside of the cranium as it doesn't burst out, but you did just, inside there was an internal explosion in its cavity there. As that thing just face down, slugged in there, as she's pulling back up, as she points behind you as that one that you just gave the opportunity to attack now charging you as it's trying to attack you. I'm gonna let you challenge it. They're both swinging at the same time. So mace versus claw here, make your attack.
Oh, it's a 23.
How do you kill this last one?
I'm just gonna baseball.
Hey, you know what? That fucking does it. You claw, just slug it out of the way as this last one finishes the work that you started earlier with that previous swing as this thing dies in front of you. There's a moment of silence there as you are hearing about twice the activity that you heard originally, with deeper within that fog, more croaks, more reinforcements. As Jay is a little stunned, she goes to Asher and she starts trying to put him over her shoulder. She's like, help me, is you already there? Mm-hmm. Okay, I need you to make a strength roll for me, please. She's not strong enough to do it. He's a big guy.
Oh, hell yeah. Okay, this is gonna be 28.
She got a 20 total, so yeah, that's plenty. So you guys have Asher. You feel his skin is cold, and he literally can't move. He has no eye movement. He's very faint breathing, if any, that you can tell. He needs medical attention ASAP. You have him now. Do you try and make a run for it?
Oh yeah, we're making a run for it.
You guys run into this fog aimlessly, just trying to avoid these croaks and these noises here, as you get just beyond what seems to be the swamp biome, as you pause behind a tree out of breath, as one of these mutated frogs reaches the edge of that swamp biome, and it seems to smell you, but it seems against its behavior to leave that line that separates the jungle from the swamp, as it just kind of growls to itself and curls its claws, and then it starts hulkingly step back and then kind of runs looking for other tributes there, as you guys seem to be in the clear. You guys have reached a new zone. It seems that this particular jungle, you hear the rushing water. It looks like there's a waterfall of fresh, it's just a small stream of fresh water that kind of goes down, as it seems to be encircling this rock formation. So there's kind of like these kind of cliff edges around you. You're kind of like in a hollow dome, as you do immediately spot that there's a cave opening here for shelter.
Wait, really quick. I'm going to dip them in the stream to try and wash out the chest.
Kind of clear out this wound, as you notice that some of that yellow venom, kind of like you guys kind of squish it out almost like you're popping a pimple, and it started to like fester inside of the wound and just hold him down. Mm-hmm. You notice that he was in a bad place. There were veins. There were like yellow veins that were crawling through his flesh, like all throughout his body as it was spreading. He's lucky that it didn't stop his heart entirely. She seems genuinely concerned for him as she gets in the backpack and takes out an official medicine and uses that item. You notice that the yellow veins start to dissipate. He starts to kind of fade back to his regular color as his breathing starts going from just like a faint like centimeter of movement to actually taking solid breaths. And he's still unconscious, and he might be for a while, but he's alive.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
Both of you are sitting at the shore, just like exhausted. Yarrow, all alone, escaped the cornucopia. First, you've grabbed your backpack and you've bolted into the unknown, into this dense jungle. Very exotic. This is like polar opposite of District 12. In your mind, you're basically running through Candyland. It's just like its own planet. As you're kind of entering a clearing, how far into this jungle do you go? Do you go just out of range of like what you hear at the cornucopia, or do you go further beyond?
I keep running.
Keep running? Okay, are you paranoid? Are you checking like over your shoulder and everything? Okay.
100%.
You get a few zones in, and it's quiet. You only hear the artificial sounds of nature around you. So you kind of have a moment to collect yourself. There are like bushes and leaves and trees obscuring certain visions. Like you don't have a full 360 of where you're at, but you're in this cute little clearing here if you'll put yourself in the middle. What's your first moment as you catch your breath?
Then I check my backpack.
Okay, roll me a d4.
Three!
You found rope!
Okay, but I also say plus one additional quantity of item found, so I have two.
So as a trader! You have two rope.
Two rope.
So technically you got six items. Your backpack can only hold eight. Funny enough, you get two electrical coil. Not that applies to you very much.
Okay.
You find two spiles.
What the
fuck? So two spigots. Nothing to hold them in. So you just get an odd array of knickknacks and
I hate this and game rope and junk. I'm gonna die.
What, you wanna call on a sponsor?
Can I take the wire and flatten it and like make it sharp against like a rock or something?
Let's have you roll a strength check for me.
17.
Okay, you could take some of this coil and you can kind of grate it down to where it is pokey. Very thin though. It won't have too wide of a puncture radius, but unless it's like, you know, it could go, it's like a needle. It could go through an eye. It could go through flesh, almost like a syringe. What's your next move?
I need to find water. No, I can make a trap for like food.
You want to make a snare?
Yeah.
A snare trap?
Yeah.
Okay, you take this long piece of rope.
Eight.
Loop it and attach. This is... but it's okay, it's okay. Which height did you want to set the snare at? At ground level or at human level? It's just this tangled, trooping...
ground level.
This eight. How long do you give it time to
you kind of perch up somewhere?
Yeah.
You try and hide?
Yeah.
Okay, tell me how you try and hide here.
I find a tree with like very low.
Okay, a drooping like drooping, giant one of those leaves.
Like giant yes. big old leaves, and I just kind of like.
Perception check for your stealth.
Fuck, 5. I'm just kind of like.
Yeah, you're kind of, you think you're like super hidden because it's like you're looking at it from one angle as the leaf's down, but the leaf is only on like the straight side. On both sides, you're just.
Completely out in the open.
Just there, your Arena suit glimmering in whatever sunlight Great. Comes down. Okay, and how long do you wait here? Or do you completely abandon the zone?
I think I lose my patience after like 20 minutes.
20 minutes? Okay, let's see what happens in 20 minutes.
God.
There is something approaching as you're stealth behind this leaf.
Not stealth
behind this leaf. Not really stealth behind this leaf. You do hear the sound of crunching twigs and
Which
leaves.
Direction?
It seems to be coming...
Behind me, in front of
not
me.
Behind you, kind of near where that snare trap would be.
Okay.
You see approaching your snare trap, Duke of District 4. He sees your snare trap, and he's like, "The fuck is this?" As he puts him on alert. You notice that he is losing an immense amount of blood very fast.
Not Duke.
He's kind of holding in like a gash so big that you might even be able to see inside, like his not like his stomach, but like you might be able to see some organs if you now patrolling this zone that you're in with his trident at the ready, as he doesn't know who the fuck set that snare trap.
Duke.
Does he see, are you, oh, like, was that just like a voice echoing through the jungle?
Yeah.
I hope I ran into the right person here.
You okay?
As you notice that his posture starts slumping down, he drops his trident onto the onto the ground as he hits the dirt on slumped across.
Duke! What do you do? I run to Duke. Can I suture him back together with some of the rope and some of the electrical wire?
If you make a glorious medicine roll, I will allow this. Okay. Otherwise, you're gonna have to use the med kit.
Does he have a med kit?
No, but you have sponsor points.
Okay, like 15?
You are trying your best to put pressure, relieve the bleeding, stop it. You use your makeshift electrical wire, that needle, as you're like sewing him with electrical cable and rope and everything. You stop the bleeding, but it does not heal him.
I'm gonna call in a sponsor for a med kit.
You activate that iPad as you have the entire menu of all weapons, all
this is very interesting.
Items, everything, as you're like checking out on Amazon. As you call in that med kit, one of your sponsored tokens is now gone.
So I erased it.
Three. This arena dome has opened up for a minute as it shoots down this beautiful little chrome canister, as you can kind of make out through the canopy because it's reflecting off the artificial sun. It's like a shiny...
Everyone else see it?
Yeah.
Fuck me!
As you hear that beeping, it's a very loud beep too. Beep, beep. It does rustle through that canopy as it does land, crashes down in front of you there.
Okay, I use the med kit.
Okay, you then actually begin to recover him.
Duke!
Sorry, as, I'm excited. It takes like 5 to 10 minutes, but he regains consciousness. What the hell?
Duke?
He immediately picks up his trident in a defensive position. Not on you, but just in general. He's not pointing at you.
Calm down.
Thank you. He's really happy that he's alive.
You're good?
I mean, as good as I can be. That was rough.
You scared me there for a minute.
You scared me. I mean, that was an awful snare trap.
I was trying my best.
I'm just glad that of all the people that I could have run into, it was you. Thank you.
I mean, you were the only one who wasn't an asshole to me, so.
That's not true. What about your district mate?
Well.
He's friendly enough.
Yeah, that's Taro. He's my district mate. Everyone else is kind of...
I don't even know where my district mate is. I don't know where Avalon is. Last I saw, she was fighting two in the cornucopia. I got out. Alexander got a cheap shot on me. But I'm lucky to be alive. They might be even falling here. This is the least I can give you for healing me. I grabbed that in the middle.
Thank you.
You don't know how much I needed this.
Oh, I do. I you are the 12 from 12. I know that you know how to use that thing.
I really hate that nickname.
Well, I mean, I'm sorry. I have a nickname. Okay. Do you want to hear my nickname?
What is it?
So back home, my little sister, she couldn't pronounce my name for like the first many, many years. And she called me Ducky instead of Duke. And so that kind of just stuck around. So
Ducky. So, yeah. I love it. Well, Ducky.
12.
What do we do?
Well, you already know what I'm going to say. Find water.
Find water. Can I take the container and the parachute from the sponsorship?
You can, but it's extremely heavy.
How heavy?
Like, I'd say like 25 pounds.
But it's a container.
Yeah, you could stuff that shit in your backpack. But it's going to count for about 3 items. Of your 8. Okay, cool. Take the sponsor. You're the first person to loot the actual container.
I've got one of these things. Do you know how to use this?
Well, just stick it in a tree.
Any tree?
I mean, we're in the rainforest, so there's got to be moisture in each of these trees.
Okay.
Where's the water going to go? We just going to drink it?
Sponsorship container, bro.
That sounds pretty heavy. You're strong enough for that? That's pretty badass.
I mean, yoinks.
We're gonna die.
Do you see how jacked I am?
I already died.
Do you see it?
I do. Okay, let's do it.
I shove this thing into a tree.
He holds the container as it fills up, as you guys just sit there enough. You guys have to use probably several trees. But luckily, in this jungle biome, the same fortune that everyone else had is that all these trees have enough moisture to at least collect some water, which is great. So you use probably about half a dozen or a dozen trees. One by one, you're about here for about... say 20 minutes.
Okay.
Well, we're not on vacation here. We should probably go. I left a huge ass blood trail.
Let's go.
It seems like you found like a little
this is like really
river
pretty.
Crossing of sorts. So you guys emerge about here. Whoops. Sorry, 12.
It's like a
huge ass river here, and then there's another side here that like has land. So it's almost like a detachment. But this river seems to go on.
Can I see the bottom?
You cannot see the bottom. No, this water.
It's a deep river.
It's like a murky dirt kind of color. It's like kind of brownish.
Okay.
But yeah, there is that clearing, and then it continues. You look to the far left, and you look to the far right, and this river goes on for a while, and it's quite wide. So it would take a while to go around.
So we have to go through
You were going to cross here, but that's optional. Immediately, Duke goes up to the thing, and he starts scanning for fish with his trident.
See anything?
He pokes his trident and he thinks he has one. He flicks it at such a fast pace. It's honestly impressive. It just goes in and sticks out on the shell. And as he seems to pull out this tiny little floppy guy, I don't know if this is edible, but
kind of sad.
I mean, we don't have anything.
It's better than nothing. Are you hungry yet?
No, but it's better to prepare. Where do you want to keep him?
I wonder if there's a way we can contain the fire so it won't have any smoke.
Sure, you can think of a way. You're smart.
Well, you saw that snare back there.
Well, we all have our strengths and weaknesses.
I guess we can try it. We can go for it. Yeah, I'll try to build a fire so we can eat this sad fish.
Are you going to try and use, the knife and, the whole, shh thing?
Yeah.
Okay, please make a survival roll for me now.
29. But to, keep the smoke out, I, put a bunch of, leaves... kind of surrounding the fire and kind of tamping it down so it's hot, but it's not smoking a whole lot.
10 minutes pass or so. No one's followed you. No one's found the smoke or the blood trail.
Well, split the fish. Couple bites.
How about since you saved my life, you have the first meal. Make a perception roll for me, please.
Great.
12. This approaches you and catches you slightly off guard. Almost ominous, creeping fog enters this brush line here as it seems to just kind of gently, almost like a mist machine, plume out of the thing as it seems to be growing in mass as you're about 10 feet away here. Duke's obviously at the shore still trying to fish as he kind of hears it, how quiet it just got. Because all nature just stops. It's silent.
Silent.
Nothing. There's nothing audible within the mist as he turns around and sees that and then obviously gets into a ready stance. He's backed up against the water.
Is there any fish left?
Yeah, the bones.
Chuck him in.
Fuck.
This fog now kind of rolls over the brush. It is now about 8 feet away from you. And about every 10 seconds or so, then it goes to 6 feet.
I back up to the shoreline with Duke and I say, that's not good.
Have you ever swam before? Okay. We'll go together then.
Well, I'm ready.
Okay, just keep paddling. Go! As the mist gets to about 2 feet now, as it's like right there, this wall of fog, as he dives into the water. Make a dexterity check without your skill.
Without my skill?
A raw D20. You guys jump in and you just aimlessly start paddling and paddling and paddling through this pitch black water as you start to hear the sound of rapid, frenzied splashing. As you look to your left above water, you see that there is a entire colony of piranhas that are jumping and spazzing out in the waters. They seem to be rapidly ascending down this river here. Whoa. As you make it to about 3/4 of the way there, Duke has already made it to the shore. Duke's like, you're doing great, come on, hurry up.
16.
These piranhas are just about, like, they are like within like feet of you as they are darting. Duke jumps into the water and helps push you as you notice that he like jumps in because he notices you're not gonna make it. He jumps in, he leaves his trident, and he starts pushing you as you both make it to the shore with seconds. Some of them kind of like are so frenzied from wanting to eat you that they kind of like flop onto shore as they're just like aimlessly like freaking out around there as you guys obviously scoot your ass back to the shore.
You hungry?
Darby, you escaped the cornucopia with nothing but a backpack over your shoulder and an arrow lodged in your calf as each step increases with pain as the adrenaline is just pumping through your veins, just keeping you together. How far away from the cornucopia do you go?
As far as I can, as long as Helen does not find me.
Constitution roll to see how far you can go here. Make me a constitution skill.
15.
You are basically pushing yourself through this jungle biome as it gets denser and denser and denser. As this overwhelming rainforest, you've never seen anything like it before, especially from the power plant's perspective. This is almost like an alien planet to you. Is there all this lush green and exotic? Everything looks like it's either venomous or poisonous, and it's just shrouded in greenery. You push in far enough to where you feel like it would take a while for someone to track you. You just stay paced. You don't collapse under the pain or the blood loss as you're hobbling through at a moderate pace. As you then stop into this clearing here, we'll put your miniature in the middle. What's your next plan of action here? What do? You are sitting here, you have your backpack, you have this arrow that is basically causing you an immense amount of pain. If you don't deal with that,
I don't know what's in this backpack yet. I can search through it. Maybe I can perform some first aid.
Okay, let's see myself. If you get lucky with this first aid kit. Please roll me a D4.
Two?
Two items. Roll me a D12 twice.
A D12 twice, got you.
The first thing that you open up in this backpack is a metal circle. You don't know exactly what the hell. It's like big. You don't realize what it is until you see what it says. Point this way up. Explosive. Duh. You have a landmine in your hands.
Oh.
You have a little trip mine in your hands, and the next thing that you pull out is a bundle of rope, and you have that bundle of rope. Nothing for you here.
I could work with this. Maybe I could tie it around the wound to stop the bleeding. It won't quite patch the open wound, but it can slow the bleeding until I can hopefully find something else.
Okay, let's make a medicine roll to see if this works here.
12.
You're noticing that the wound is becoming infected.
Ooh.
And if you don't find some way to dislodge this arrow and start treating it, it's almost going to be too painful. If you let this linger, you're going to become immobile.
Okay.
Let's have a medicine roll check. You have to beat the dice challenge of 13 to dislodge this arrow without causing further pain.
That's a 6.
You receive 9 damage as you pull out this arrow, and it almost has. You see that this arrow tip is designed in such a psychotic way that it's basically, when you get struck with these arrows, it almost like a tick, how its pinchers latch onto the skin so it's harder to rip out. As you rip it out, you gash that wound even further, taking that damage. You have about a day before that becomes nice and ripe and infected. What's your next move, Darby?
I think while it's still bright, maybe I can find some herbs or something to maybe stop the infecting.
Let's see if you can find those herbs. Let's get you a survival roll here. You remember reviewing some of the notes?
16.
You remember reviewing the pamphlets and the notes in the training centers in the survival area where Susie and Maeve were hanging out a couple times. You do recognize one of the plants. It's a leaf. It seems like this leaf might be able to tend to or slow down the infection. In District 11, they would use these leaves to reduce the swelling of Tracker Jacker's venom.
All those things. I'm going to stop this fucking infection.
Okay, so you slow down the infection. You apply. Do you use the rope to tie it to the wound?
Yes.
Okay, so you kind of make a little bit of that rope, you know, rip off a little bit, tighten it around that calf of yours or the shin, and the leaf is there sitting doing its job.
Ooh, hell in you, bitch. Okay, now I need to find some food. I'm not going to be able to eat the landmine. Maybe I can find some water and maybe purify it.
You aimlessly wander. You have stopped leaving a blood trail for probably a zone or two. Probably for the last 10 minutes there, since you applied the leaf. As you wander through the zones for a bit, you do come across an opening, a gap, a cliff indent here. It seems like you found a stream of running water that's beneath this cliff. It's about a 50-foot cliff, and there is a tree, a collapsed tree that seems to be a bridge across. Like it's almost like you could probably, if you stand completely stiff, it's probably enough to walk with both feet, but otherwise you'll be shimmying across this. There seems to be a path on the other side that might lead down to this fresh source of water for you to investigate.
I have to play the fucking shimmy game on a fucked up leg. Great. How shallow is this?
You can't really tell how deep or shallow this is, but you are about 50 feet in the air.
No, that might.
This is definitely a cliff. Your rope can go about probably 15 feet at this point.
Okay. The rope I have as kind of a safety buffer. However, I might have to sacrifice the rope. I could tie it on the end that I'm kind of standing on.
Almost like a harness?
A harness to help kind of secure me as I'm crossing this on my bad leg.
Absolutely fantastic. You secure yourself to it. It's slippery. There seems to be a layer of moss that makes it a little bit harder. Please make your first dexterity roll for me, please.
And 3. Fuck.
A 3 and a 7?
Yeah.
Slip! Your foot comes under you as you literally fall backwards, as you free fall off this log. About 15 feet before that rope catches you. As you are swaying. It catches your fall as you were seeing that. That you notice that you almost heard a little at the top. It's a very reinforced log, but your body weight almost cracked it at the middle as you are dangling. You can't even touch the sides of each of the gorges. You are literally just suspended. Oh. As you start to hear laughter, you hear the laugh.
Who's laughing?
Of Helen.
Fuck!
Darby. Darby, 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 Darby. As you see, as you're swinging through this gorge, as Helen tauntingly laughs, as you see that she peers over the gorge and sees you dangling there, Beau there, as you also see standing next to her is Malice of District 2, as he hulkingly starts kind of kicking the log, just testing its stability, as you kind of like, you a couple splinters kind of hit you in the head there, as he's like,
hey,
gonna drop it.
What's up, guys?
Darby, your blood was so thick that it was so easy to find you. What did I say again? First one in the shin, second one
in the arm, third one in the leg.
She launches an arrow at you. Please make a dodge. Please make a raw d20 roll here to see if she hits or miss. You have to beat a 17.
Crit!
Oh! Then you do dodge one of those, the fucking arrows there, and she's pissed.
Yeah, you weren't as close as last time. Was that supposed to hit me?
Malice begins to walk on the log. He begins to try and cross, to try and get to where your rope is secure there. As Helen goes for another shot, please make another raw d20 roll for me. As she launches this one, you need to be a 19.
You're fucking joking. This is a 15.
This arrow, a very similar pain now hits you, and she's laughing, and she is excited about watching you. You're basically swaying underneath this gorge here with now this arrow protruding from you. It kind of makes you enter a little spin a little bit. Darby, Darby, Darby.
Yes, that's my name.
I almost feel bad, but this is just too much fun.
Yeah, I bet it is. I bet it is.
Malice seems to be about a quarter of the way to the rope.
While I'm swinging, while they're fucking around, can I reach for the landmine? And while I'm, because you said that I'm still kind of like swinging after getting hit. While I'm swinging, since I'm halfway through, as I'm swinging, can I attach the landmine to that edge?
You don't reach the sides of the gorge, but what you can do is you can throw it. You can arm and throw it, and it will detonate on impact.
I'd like to throw it like a frisbee at both of those fuckers.
And may the odds be in your favor as you throw.
And what are they doing right now? Like, oh,
so Malice is currently tiptoeing across to basically grab your rope and undo it. And then Helen's sitting on the edge to shoot you with more arrows. You see that she's kind of drawing up.
Okay.
What's after the arm, Darby?
I just rolled a 14. What's after the arm? This. This.
As that mine goes with the 14, it clips right in between both of them as a massive explosion. You see that as it was going, Helen took a nosedive that way, and then Malice is stuck on this fucking log with you as that bomb, roll me 2d20.
Roll 2d20? Fuck. 3 and 13, that's 16.
That's 16 damage as that blast not only sends both of them flying, wounding them, you see that Malice is... He flies off the fucking log as he descends down to this gorge as you're seeing him as the log that's holding both of you rattled from the explosion immediately snaps and you go free falling into the gorge. Please make a constitution roll. Constitution. Both of you are about to hit the water from 50 feet in the air.
Well, that's my top skill. So, all right, 2d20s. That's a 9 and a 6. 15.
Boom! You hit the water. Swirl and everything is faded and blurry as everything goes almost, you can't move, you're in so much pain that you're just falling with this this current goes. You don't know where Malice is in this. It seems like with your 16, you're able to make one ditch effort on how you want to control your swimming, whether you want to go for shore, whether you want to follow the stream down, whether you want
to
just...
I'm going to try to go off to the side. Maybe there's some land or something I could kind of like grab and escape.
Dexterity roll. And then you also take... How much health do you have?
10.
You have 10? Yeah. Are you fucking kidding me? You just take 7 more damage as you hit from fall damage as you hit that water. You have 3 HP? You have 3 HP?
3 HP.
Okay, make that dex roll.
2 and a...
Come on.
And a 9.
You missed one of the first opportunities to grab it. As you notice that this water seems to be picking up in intensity in the rapids as it's heading toward the waterfall. You only have 2 more chances to get out of this fucking stream, or you're going plunging to your death.
That's a 5 and a 7. 6 and a 1.
You are approaching the rapid whites of the waterfall going down as you make one last ditch effort with that 12 as you grab on to a vine with your fucking life. You do see Malice, he is approaching as well, as you see that he's hung on to
on
to the wall there as he's like trying to like reach for you as he's hanging on for the wall. As your vine,
don't touch me.
Your vine snaps. And as you go off the waterfall into nothing, make one last constitution roll for me, please.
Oh my fucking god. That's a 6 and a 19.
You go unconscious for somehow, you don't know what the hell happens, but an unknown amount of time has passed as you seem to have washed up on some shore. You don't know whether or not somebody saved you, whether it was luck or chance, but you have 1 health left.
How the f-
As you are on this, you are on this almost beach-like shore. Look up and you notice that a chrome canister with a silk parachute.
What?
Do you open it?
I'm almost like looking like, please, like if I don't catch at least one break, if Darby doesn't catch at least one break, I hesitantly, with 1 HP and very wide, nervous, probably just bloodied face, just opens the canister.
As you open it, there is what seems to be a med kit. There seems to be medicine, a food supply, a canteen. All of the survival necessities are within this canister, as there seems to be a whiskey glass with a note inside of it.
Farron! Maybe I'm not alone in this, like you said, right? I hope it's whiskey. What's it say?
You wanna read it?
Yeah.
Okay. You open up this parchment and it is dense. There is a lot of writing on this parchment as you recognize Farron's handwriting. First it says, I told you you're not alone in this. I got your back. You're acting like a damn fool out there. But there's more. He starts... It almost feels like he's putting more pressure on the pen here as he's writing this as fast as possible. A lot has happened since the games have begun. The Gingerjack, the residents of District 7, stormed into her neighborhood and hung her parents. They haven't seen her brothers. It doesn't stop there either. Our home, District 5, is following suit. Another protest has begun, and know who they're rallying behind? Michaela. And there's threats of violence. Peacekeepers are being sent to both districts, but this is where you come in. The Capitol and the Game Makers have put a hit on Angel of District 7 and Michaela of District 5, a bounty. The one who kills any of these tributes
can receive up to 10 sponsors. If you want to win, you know what to do. That shot wasn't for the pain. It was to cope. Signed, Farron.
I'm gonna have to kill Michaela. I'm gonna have to kill my own district mate.